The first speaker will be Daniel Cordova. Daniel Cordova earned a PhD in economics at the Grinnell University, France, and currently he serves as the Dean of the School of Economics at the Peruvian University of Applied Sciences, UPC, a school he launched in 2003. He recently founded the Invertir Institute, a nonprofit institution that promotes entrepreneurship in Peru. Dr. Cordova is author of several academic articles on institutional economic development and corporate governance. He's also director of the Invertir monthly magazine and columnist at the El Comercio, a Peruvian newspaper. He led the research team that worked on the case studies on the Añaños family and Color Real and the case of the Flores family and Top It Top for Lessons from the Poor. The second speaker will be Martin Simoneta. He's executive director of Fundación Atlas 1953 in Argentina. In 2004, he was elected the Outstanding Young Person of Argentina. He has been the editor of several books, among them Public Policy Solutions for a Country in Crisis, A Successful Market-Oriented Policies, and Freedom Heroes. He holds a bachelor's degree in international relations and an MA in international economic policy. He was part of the research team that worked on the case study on the barters clubs in Argentina, which is also including Lessons for the Poor. And finally, let me introduce you, Thompson Ayodele. He's the director of Initiative for Public Policy Analysis, a public policy think tank promoting the institutions of a free society in Lagos, Nigeria. He got a degree in humanities and received a diploma in law. He's currently coordinator of Malaria Free Zones, a hedge fund Free Africa Foundation project in Cameroon, Nigeria, and the Benin Republic. His articles have been published in the New York Times, Financial Times, Australia Financial Review, and other major newspapers around the world. And he's author of Why Informal Businesses Thrive in Nigeria. He worked on the case study on the Nigerian clothing design industry for Lessons for the Poor. So let's start with Daniel Cordova. Thank you.
Thank you, Gabriel. I want to thank, first of all, Alvaro and the Independent Institute for the opportunity that they give us to write the first two cases of the book. And also the university where I work to choose my team to work on these cases. The current economic crisis is, of course, a problem we have that let us a little bit more difficult to talk about free market solutions for poverty. It's a little used to explain for example, a conservative financial regulation must be part of the institutional structure of the capitalism. The fact is that we are facing an ideal scenario for the resurgence of thesis contrary to capitalism as a system. A scenario that justifies state interventions, such as the theft of the private retirement savings in Argentina by the Kirchner's marriage, who one journalist of our country nicknamed Bonnie and Clyde. The problem is not new. This book was written before the emergence of this new economic context. But the perception of the enterprise as a vehicle for some people to get rich at the cost of others is in the mental hard drive of too many people, especially of international intellectuals, of officials. I remember that when we organized in Lima the International Convention of Economics a couple of years ago about the private enterprise and the fight against poverty, a friend of mine, an officer of the World Bank, looked at me at in surprise when he saw the title, and he told me, what have to do a private enterprise with the fight against poverty? And I also remember that 14 years ago, when I was working in a program, for a typical World One program, fight against poverty, I proposed a program to bring together the private companies with exported carmen, with peasants, to put together these companies with peasants who produced the cactus, which is the source of the natural colorant. And my boss at that time phoned and said to me, we are not here to promote exports, we are here to fight against poverty. After which he did not renew my contract, of course. So let me use this minute to highlight how the two cases that rose for Lesson from the Poor, I think, can contribute some way to three objectives. In first place, to bury definitively the development theory, which considered that entrepreneurial development from poverty in the framework of a free market economy was impossible. In second place, to show how entrepreneurial development is not only the best antidote against poverty for those who achieve successful dealings, but also as a business aim to the low-income market, contributing to the raising of the standard of living of the poorest. And in third place, let me say a few words about the importance of works being carried out by the institution like the Center for Global Prosperity and the Invertir Institute in Lima to deepen our knowledge with regard to the nature of the enterprise, about what type of institutional barriers inhibit entrepreneurial development, and about the kind of institution which favor entrepreneurial success. Those among us who were trained as an economist in Latin America in the 80s receive our dosage of the theory of CEPAL, and even more so of the dependency theory. As you can remember, according to the CEPAL and his icon, Raúl Prebisch, Latin America must apply protectionism as a way to become industrial countries. And every relations, free relationship between the Latin American countries and developed countries was seen as a way to become, to stay as underdeveloped countries. And the dependency theory was, of course, worse. I remember there was a German economist with a doctorate in Chicago, André Gunder Frank, that said that development of Western countries had taken place thanks to the exploitation of the peripheral countries. No? So one of the industrial sectors that was most mercantile and committed to the CEPAL theory in my country, in Peru, was the textile industry. And Peru has a disaster, economic disaster, between the 60s and the 80s, thanks to, in good part, with this protectionist policy. But when the economy of Peru was opened in the 90s, and custom duties, for example, were reduced radically, those businessmen were the ones who reacted, of course, initially most violently against this. No, they at that time they it was considered to be the imminent destruction of the process of the incipient and inefficient clothing manufacturing industry in Peru. Well, what happened was exactly the opposite. No, only a few years were needed for the majority of the old textiles manufacturers to recover themselves for to export, and for Peru to increase the value of its exports of clothing from $300 million to $2 billion. Some of them were the traditional businessmen, of course, who recover. But also we saw some new players come in the sector. And I remember looking at the statistic in my office to see a nice name, Topi Top. We didn't know who was those people. I asked to some of our economists, who are those people of Topi Top? And he told me, well, it's Aquilino Flores, someone who no one knows in town. So it was a new player. Aquilino Flores was a new player, but not just any player. One player who came from the bottom rung of the ladder. One who began with zero capital, zero property ownership, an informal vendor, as an informal vendor, to end up being one of the most important formal businessmen of my country. Aquilino starts as he started washing cars at the central market in Lima in the 60s. And one day, a client of him asked him to sell some T-shirts. He gave him 20 T-shirts in order to him to sell it in a week. Well, Aquilino sold it in one day. And in this way, he started to be a dealer of T-shirts, then a producer, and dealer by dealer. He called his brother from Huancavelica, one of the poorest part of Peru, and he became a producer and then exporter, and he became rich. But he's still a humble man. He's still proud of his. Origins, and of course his children now are well educated and are businessmen in a modern way. But it's a wonderful story. I hope that you can read it in the book, and I won't summarize the story. But I canceled my part of my lecture to show you a first short video about how the company of Aquilino look now. It's just a 3 minutes video. It's an institutional video, but just to show you his company now.
Established 25 years ago, and with a complete vision of quality, Topi Top has managed to achieve a number one ranking as an exporter of top knit goods, continuing with the great textile tradition in Peru. Vertically integrated, from selection of cotton lots until the packaging of goods ready for our client stores, and achieving on-time delivery, and all this at a great price. Topi Top has positioned itself as a factory that exceeds customer expectations, being able to produce great volumes for a big range of markets. We have a capacity of 3.5 million garments per month, using different fabrics such as jersey, interlock, peak, fleece, French terry, solids and stripes, both engineering and feed. All of this with a quality that is supervised by our demanding lab tests required by our customers, which can be done in our certified in-house lab or in external client-approved labs. We have a large yarn dye operation, an excellent knitting house and dye house, combined with our complete fabric finishing process that allow us to deliver fabric that is ready for per cutting room, where with automated machines guarantee precision in our cuts. With great Peruvian labor, combined with their great needle expertise, we manufacture garments with a big range, from basic tees to box collars, combining it with fashion garments that added to a great print house and embroidery operation. We incorporate value added to our garments with different techniques. All of our garments can be washed with different techniques, such as sand wash, bleach wash, pigment garment dyes, sprays where we can incorporate a unique look to our garments. All of this could be impossible without a great HR team in the areas of logistics, engineering, planning, supported by both a system support team that incorporates on the data center solutions such as SAP, and supported by an ISO 9000 certification that guarantees our processes. Topitop, bringing the great textile Peruvian tradition to the world.
Okay, this company was founded by a man that washed cars, used to wash cars 4 years ago. The experience of the Topitop is one case that proved that the entrepreneurship and success business is possible in a country like Peru, starting from poverty. But the other case that I wrote for the book was the Añaños case, and that is another interesting case, because the Añaños family start in Ayacucho, in a moment when the Shining Path, the Maoist terrorist movement, was in his best situation. The Ayacucho was the center of the Maoist movement, and the trucks of Pepsi Cola and Coca Cola refused to go there because it was too dangerous. So the Añaño family look at this opportunity, and they start to produce some soda, in a used bottle of beer. And they started that way, and then they became more important, more formal. They discovered a new market, the market of the bottom of the pyramid, And they started to produce cola for people who, at that time, didn't have the opportunity to buy a Coca-Cola because it was too expensive for them, but they want these sodas. So the Añaños start to grow in the countryside of Peru, then in Lima, then in Venezuela, Central America, Mexico. Now they are in Asia. They, this year they will have a revenue for $1.2 billion. They are the most important Peruvian transnational company. And they start 20 years ago in the center of the most dangerous region of Peru. I don't like to talk too much. I have another video, and with that, I will just finish with some conclusion after that video, because I thought that you can read the case, but maybe you won't have the opportunity to see the experience of the Añaños family and to see them how they start. The video is in Spanish, but we have subtitles in English, so you can see easily it. Thank you.
Ayacucho, hace 20 años, una herida abierta. Miedo y violencia se respiraban en sus calles, en sus hogares, dolor y lágrimas. Bajo el sol ayacuchano, trabajando y amando su tierra del Valle de San Miguel, los hermanos Añaños crecieron en el seno de una familia sólida que, apoyados a una férrea unión, los forjó como hombres y mujeres capaces de convertir la adversidad en oportunidad. Así nace el gran sueño, un auténtico reto, crear una marca nueva de bebidas gaseosas y que ésta llegara a todos los rincones del Perú. Los ahorros familiares, la venta de sus tractores y un primer préstamo de $22,000 entregado por el entonces Banco Industrial convirtieron a la familia en pequeños industriales. Las actividades agrícolas dejaron lugar a interminables jornadas de trabajo al frente de una rudimentaria línea de producción que funcionaba en la casa familiar. Aquí, en 1988, se envasa la primera producción de una nueva gran marca peruana, Cola Real. El proyecto ya tomaba forma, y los siguientes pasos de la nueva marca también fueron, cada uno, un reto para la familia. En el año 1991, la empresa estaba lista para salir de Ayacucho e inaugura su segunda planta en Huancayo. Paso a paso, peldaño a peldaño y reto a reto, la marca empezó a consolidar su posición de liderazgo, logrando éxitos en nuevos mercados. La aceptación lograda por la marca fortaleció a la organización y la puso en condiciones para conquistar cada vez más provincias. La respuesta del público es más que positiva y se forma una relación óptima entre el consumidor y la marca, gracias a que satisface las necesidades de sus consumidores sin sobreprecios por franquicias, gastos excesivos ni campañas millonarias. El público siente que una nueva marca es por fin como ellos, peruana, noble, austera, sabrosa, solidaria. Y el sueño crece. Y los retos también. Ahora se presentaba el gran reto de conquistar el mercado limeño. Así, en el 97, la planta de Liva empieza su producción. Pronto, la bebida se convirtió en la favorita de miles y miles de limeños, cuya preferencia repite la experiencia vivida por los consumidores de las provincias. Descubrieron un producto de calidad y un gran sabor, a un precio justo, acorde a sus posibilidades. Sin dejar de crecer y superando el límite impuesto por el mercado limeño, se inauguran nuevas plantas cubriendo así totalmente el territorio nacional. Gracias a identificar con precisión las necesidades del consumidor, aplicando una eficiente política de gastos controlados, modernas técnicas marqueteras y con una efectiva publicidad, la marca llegó a ser no solo un producto preferido por los consumidores, sino llegando incluso a convertirse en un auténtico fenómeno. Su contribución a la economía del país es impactante. Hizo crecer el mercado de bebidas gaseosas, que era de 389 millones de litros en el 96, llegando a 1.320 millones de litros en el 2006. Y benefició con sus precios a 28 millones de peruanos, muchos de los cuales se convertían por primera vez en consumidores de bebidas gaseosas. Y los esfuerzos se concentran en posicionar la marca como la más grande del Perú. A finales de los años 90, los hermanos Añaños se propusieron otro reto más: introducir al grupo a nivel continental. Fieles a su filosofía y trabajando con más empuje que nunca, en 1999 se da el primer paso para la conquista de mercados internacionales y se inaugura la planta en Valencia, Venezuela. Luego el grupo llega al Ecuador en el 2000. El 2002 es un año simbólico para el grupo, pues ingresa a uno de los mercados más competitivos del mundo y uno de los más grandes, México. En el 2004 se abre la planta de San José, de Costa Rica. En el 2005 se inaugura la planta de Guatemala, iniciándose también ese mismo año las actividades en Nicaragua. En el 2006 se inician las operaciones en El Salvador y en el 2007 se incorpora Honduras. Una audaz decisión lleva al grupo a ingresar a los mercados de Asia, inaugurando su planta de Tailandia en el 2006. A ella se suma la recientemente inaugurada planta de Bogotá, Colombia. Hoy, la organización sigue diversificando su producción, lanzando permanentemente nuevas marcas que van logrando importantes participaciones. Vic-Cola, un auténtico fenómeno de talla mundial, que hoy satisface a millones de consumidores en América y Asia. Agua Cielo, una marca histórica que hizo crecer el mercado de aguas más de 20 veces desde su lanzamiento. Sprite, una marca que ha permitido acceder a las bebidas rehidratantes a millones de nuevos consumidores en el Perú y América Latina. Pulp, un caso de éxito que hizo crecer la categoría de jugos y néctares de 30 a 120 millones de litros y que ha logrado la mejora de la nutrición de la niñez y de la calidad de vida de millones de familias. Oro. First, marca multisabor que disfruta en 7 países. Freelight, exitosa incursión del grupo en el terreno de las aguas funcionales, y Seafruit, un nuevo miembro de la familia que ya marcó el paso en el mercado de los Citrus Punch, con un sabor que hoy disfrutan públicos de diversos países. Y el nuevo gran reto del grupo, ingresar al mercado cervecero con Franca, una cerveza francamente peruana, con el sabor que tú te mereces. Franca, sabor que recompensa. Todo esto ha demostrado que el grupo es capaz de alcanzar cualquier meta, cumplir cualquier sueño. Pues como dice don Eduardo Ñaños, los sueños deben ser grandes. Así, manteniendo la misma filosofía de sus inicios, hoy tenemos el orgullo de presentarnos ante el mundo entero como AGE, una organización de ideas audaces que se atreve a competir en los más exigentes mercados, siendo un auténtico modelo de eficiencia, con el gran compromiso de brindar bienestar a las personas. El futuro de AGE se resume en una frase de doña Mirta de Añaños: el planeta es grande, una gran familia y una sólida filosofía sustentada en la unión. Hace 20 años, 15 empleados en el Perú. Hoy, más de 10.000 trabajadores directos e indirectos alrededor del mundo. 20 plantas, muchos retos, un solo sueño. Por eso, con absoluto orgullo por lo nuestro, decimos que AGE es una gran empresa peruana que llega al mundo y que nace en el Perú. AGE, del Perú para el mundo.
Tan peruana como tú, realmente como tú. Es tuya, AGE es nuestra, AGE es de todo el Perú. AGE está contigo, está con todo el Perú. AGE está contigo, está con todos, está con todo el Perú.
I think that the lesson here is that not only we have not to think only about the employment and the generation of wealth from the company, but also the generation of a new way of living for people with this business for that allow the these people to have access to soft drinks that they were not able before. No, and to just to conclude, the third lesson is for research. You know, we have still a lot of work to do in order to understand why entrepreneurship appears in some societies in such a way, and why in some other societies these kind of stories are not possible. How it comes that this kind of stories were possible in a context of high transaction costs, in a context of such a weak institution, and we have a lot of research to do and a lot of work to do also to promote freedom and to promote free enterprise to really fight successfully against poverty. Thank you very much.